it's on. Oh, there we have it. It's on now. Like I was saying, good morning, everyone. It's good to be back to fellowship together. I see my wife has returned from her Sabbath school responsibilities of leading the junior class. Let's start this morning with hymn number 531. I trust this will be in keeping with what Brother Mark is going to be bringing to us this morning. If you'll notice, just one page to the left, number 529 is the closing hymn. So we're in the same section. Hymn number 531. And just a side note, if you'll notice, there's no page number. So if somebody says page 531, you're going to have to count the pages until you get to page number 531. But hymn number, boy, that's indexed right there. Good time when we get to heaven, won't we?
Yes.
It'll be fantastic. Just beyond the belief and the imagination, what we have in our minds today. Why? Because we are mortal, not immortal. Can you explain to me what infinity is like? If so, I'll double it. In fact, I'll go better than that. I'll raise it to the infinity power. And then we still will be infinity short. Anyway, enough of my gallagalling around. Have a good time there, Dan. Yeah, get a bulletin. All right, let's take a look at our bulletins this morning and see what we have for this coming week. right at the very top on our scheduled events and meetings, you'll see that we have not forgotten prayer meeting, Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. Next Sabbath will be a highlight. What? Why? Well, because it'll be the first Sabbath of the new year. No, not the first Sabbath of just the new year. The first Sabbath of the new year that we will have a fellowship meal. What a fantastic time that will be. And I'll give you a little, what should I say? Hint. We are going to be visited by a couple that used to be here for many, many years. That couple is coming from Holt, which is just south of Lansing. Do you know who that couple might be? Yeah. My wife's sister and husband, Sandy and Everett Kittleson, they will be here next Sabbath.
Amen.
So during that fellowship meal, you'll be able to chat with them, I trust. Now, after the fellowship meal, what grand event do we have planned? What grand event do we have planned? Well, it's right there in your bulletin. Fellowship meal and meeting. One of my wife's favorite things is a meeting. After the fellowship meal, there will be a planning meeting. And I'll give you another little, well, what do they call it when they give you the answer to a great mystery, and it's something breaks. Anyway, who will be here? Well, another couple that we hold dear to our hearts, Jan and Rich Kroniak, will be back. At least the plans are such that he would be back, and Jan back on the 23rd at the latest, and they will be here also. So during that Sabbath, next Sabbath on the 24th, we will not only have the first fellowship meal of the new year, but also the planning meeting. And who is going to help out in leading that? Our Rich Kroniak. The first Sabbath in May. What's the date? Should we say the second Sabbath in May? How about May 8th? Is that the first or second Sabbath of May?
Probably second.
The second Sabbath. And what will Dave Schultz be doing on May 8th? Well, it's right there in your bulletin. Anybody know what an induction service is? That's where they stand and give their oath and commit themselves to the Pathfinders. That induction service will be on May 8th. And a brief lunch will be following that service, by the way. Strong Tower Radio is still in our bulletin. And as you can read there, if you would like to make a gift to Strong Tower Radio, a donation, it gives you all sorts of ways of contacting them in regards to giving a gift. And if you need to know as to what they need money for, they have a list a mile long. It's the length of your arm. In fact, there's so many things on that list, they have to put it on a thumb drive. That's the way my medications are. I have them listed on a thumb drive and a spreadsheet so I know when to take them. Oh, boy. Well, Sarah Lynn, my spouse, has an announcement to make. All yours, dear.
Okay, I better take this off. This is for the gals in church. Remember I talked about women's ministry retreat at Asabo? You know, usually a lot of you, we don't get to go. I'm usually in Florida, so I haven't gone. I've never gone because of that. Well, and then this year we have the pandemic, so only the leaders could go, okay? Well, unfortunately, I'm not able to go. But anyway, all of us can watch it here's the address. So if you have a pencil or a pen, you can go on your smartphone or, I don't know, your computer? Can you go on computer? Okay, I'm very ignorant when it comes to the computer thing. Anyway, here it is. Are you ready? It's www.michiganwm.com. The WM would be Women's Ministry. Do I need to say that again? Yes, that's a good question. I was just going to mention that. Yep, www.michiganwm.com. And it's going to be, it's already started last night, but the nice thing is, I believe, when they live stream, you can go to, it says it will show on Facebook, YouTube, and live stream direct from our website. And it's a free event this year. Some of the churches are actually charging if you go to view it. They had a speaker last night, which, sad to say, I forgot and I didn't see it, but I know I can catch up on it. And then today, of course, a lot of things are going on while we're here at church, but their next speaker will be at 4:30 today. So if you want to go to live stream, if you know how to do that, hope you can help me. But anyway, they have warrior, it's called Warriors Not Worriers is the theme, Warriors Not Worriers. So I think that's a really, really good title and everything. So it would be nice if you could catch some of these because normally we don't get to. So this is one time that this is happening. So that's a good thing of the pandemic. Many bad things, but there is some good things. So thank you.
I trust all of you have that information, so you'll rush to your computers and log in and watch Women's Ministries. Is there any other announcements that someone might have? Not seeing any, we'll proceed into our divine worship service.
Our Father, it's with a deep contrition of heart that we come before you to bow, to worship, to repent, to ask for the indwelling of your Holy Spirit transforming our lives. We pray that Jesus would be revealed in thought, in word, and deed, as he is the one who we have come to worship. May your Spirit be in each heart, that we might receive that which you have prepared for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our opening hymn is number one. Number one, praise to the Lord. In the hymnal.
You can be seated. Before Chuck leads us in our morning prayer, we're going to sing one more song. It's going to be up on the screen. So Scott, if you could put that up. Let's join with Kristen and Keith Getty in their song, He Will Hold Me Fast.
Thank you. now that time of the morning in our service that we approach the Lord's throne and speak to Him, our garden of prayer. If it were not for the pandemic, I would invite people to come forward to get close to the throne of God. Whereas considering the social distancing guidelines that we must follow, shall we just remain in our pews with bowed heads for our main prayer?
Gracious Lord, our Heavenly Father, the one who has given us so much for which we are grateful. In thy presence, Lord, this morning, we bow before thee, humbling our hearts as we approach thy throne. Lord, we look forward to seeing your face. As we go through this world, this earth, and all of the sin that's within it, we pray that we will be like Noah, chosen as a select few for your redemption. We pray, Lord, this morning that you will do your part as we are doing our part in overcoming this pandemic. We see the light at the end of the tunnel and pray, Lord, that you will keep us close to you, rock solid in your arms, protected from this world. May we humble ourselves and look forward to your soon coming. May your Holy Spirit walk these aisles and these pews this morning, touching our hearts as we listen to the word from on high through Brother Mark. We pray, Lord, that we will get a rich spiritual blessing, and may your attributes, your infinity, your immortality, rain down on us this morning so that we might be spiritually moved, that we might take in and absorb what you have for us in today. Keep us in the hollow of thy hand, Lord, we pray. Forgive us where we've fallen. May we see you soon in the clouds of glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Sabbath. What a wonderful day we have out there. Sun shining, we had rain here all week long, make things grow and get green. Edelgard probably really likes that, you know, makes her garden grow. And look at the beautiful flowers she brought in this morning. It's wonderful. Today's offering is for local church budget. And I'm going to see if I can do this on my smartphone. Okay. Here's a reading from the conference. How can you maintain a church school? Your congregation is so small. This question came from parents whose membership was at a nearby church that had no school of its own. We are so thankful to send our children here, but we do see how you manage. Our church can't even afford a school. The church school often struggles with finances, but by the end of each fiscal year, it had stayed within the budget. The pastor and the church determined that educating the youth of the church was a top church priority. It's our investment in the church's future, the pastor explained. The children from their church school would grow to be the church of the future. Not only that, but there would be eternal heavenly rewards for this church who had invested in the Christian education of their young people. So despite their challenges, this church channeled 60% of their church budget to keep the church school in the black. They rejoiced to continue the sacrifice to keep their church school. Their church school still operates today. The results are very clear. Many of the youth from school are still active members in a worldwide church. These youth give thanks for the spiritual care that the teachers and the faculty provided to those members who contributed to the church budget year after year. The Bible is very clear. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he won't depart from it. Very important. And I'd just like to share you a small testimony of me. I never thought that I could ever give tithes and offerings because I never had very much money, and I thought I could never afford to live. But 4 years ago, I started giving tithes and offerings. And with the little that I have, God never let me down. I always have food on the table. I'm able to heat my home. I'm able to drive into town and do all the church duties, different things that we do. He's never let me down. I've always got. Some months it's a little tight, you know, but at the end, it's just, everything works out. So I just praise the Lord for that. And His Word says that. Try me, you know, and pay your tithes, you know. And I did. I tried God, you know, and He's never let me down. So I just praise the Lord for that. And anyway, the offering plates are in the back. And you can put your offering there in there today. And let's have a word of prayer. Father, we are so thankful for your grace, your mercy, your blessings upon us, and your love. Father, everything that we have belongs to you. And we are stewards of what we have. So, Father, we ask your blessings upon this offering. May it be used for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Now's the time that we all enjoy. The children's story. If you don't enjoy the children's story, just bear with us for a moment. Heather is going to bring it to us this morning.
Thank you. this little girl. She was about 10 or 8 years old, and she was very worried, very nervous all the time. So one day she had to go to school to have a math test done, and she was so worried that she almost threw up her breakfast. But her mother told her that she better go get it done. She begged to stay home, but her mother told her that she just had butterflies in her stomach. They would go away as soon as the math test was done. So she went, and then she forgot the questions for fraction worksheet. So she asked a friend, let's call it Carol. She asked her friend Carol if she could help her at recess with her last math worksheet that she hadn't figured out yet. So after recess, she knew all the problems for math worksheet. And then the next day, she had a reading assignment to do. She loved to read, just not out loud in front of everybody. So the teacher realized just how scared Nellie was, and she told her, doing it the first time is always a little scary, but the more you do it, the more you won't be afraid. So she did it, and then her friend was sitting next to her, and he was so nervous that he dropped his book on the floor. All the kids started laughing, but the teacher said, this is not funny. I know you were laughing at the book falling on the floor, but to Judd, it may feel like you're laughing at him. I think you need to apologize. And then the next student that read, Carol, she was asked to read. And so she read the paragraph that John was supposed to read, but he dropped his book. And so she took his place, and Nellie marveled at how not nervous she looked. And so she asked her, Carol, how do you be brave in front of all these kids? And she said, well, it's because I've read a lot more, and I'm not afraid of speaking up front as much as you are. And so when she had to read again, she wasn't as afraid of before. And the teacher complimented her, and then she told the rest of the class, you may have different talents, but you're good at whatever you do, and God will give you the courage to do what he wants you to do if you just ask him. So let's pray. Dear Jesus, please help us to not be nervous like Nellie, and help us to be brave and do what we're supposed to do. And it's our job to do it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you, Heather. Well done. We appreciate that so much. I've heard the worry is like rocking in a rocking chair. I'm sure you've heard this too. There's a lot of motion, but you don't get anywhere. It's now time for our personal ministries, and I believe I captured him up here on the platform. Is that correct, Brother Boyk?
Yes. I think Elder
Chuck pretty much covered everything on the announcement this morning. After our fellowship meal on the 24th, we are going to have a meeting on how we can reach this community for Jesus, going on the way Christ walked with people and mingled with people. So anyway, we are going to have this after the fellowship meal on the 24th. And Elder Rich told me that he's going to be here no later than the 23rd, like Chuck had mentioned. And he's going to be conducting the meeting. And so anyway, that's about all I have to say. Chuck, pretty much, Elder Chuck, he pretty much covered everything on that. So anyway, I'm glad to see that we're kind of getting back to a little bit of normalcy, what we had before, you know. But our main objective is to reach Alpena with Jesus Christ. And I really, truly believe that God set this church over here for the Alpena community, that we have to reach out to them. We are living in the last days, and we have to do everything through God's Spirit. You know, we can't do it on our own. So I'm asking everybody just to pray and pray and pray that we will be led by the Spirit of God to reach this community. And we just, the Lord's given us His heart. He said in His word that He does not wish that anyone should perish, but all should come to repentance. So that's what we have to do. But we can't do it on our own. Jesus said in His word, without me, you can't do anything. So we got to make sure that we're following and walk the way He walked. And that's all I have to say.
Amen.
I'm sorry, I have to do it as a start of personal ministries. I should have said this earlier. A Bible study that I'm doing, Jan and I do it together, but when she's gone, I've been following through with it. Jeanette, you know Jeanette, you may not know, but her husband Chad had a stroke. I believe it was yesterday. She would like prayer, this is a personal ministry type thing. Anyway, he had was given TPA at a hospital in some state. They then had to fly him to Iowa because they can deal with strokes at the hospital he was taken to. He's at Iowa City University, and then we'll be updated as things go on. She did say a further message that he's in ICU, and he's right now having to lay flat for so many hours, no food or drink, and that they're doing many tests. So just keep Jeanette and her husband Chad in prayer. Thank you.
Good morning, church, and happy Sabbath. It's time for our scripture reading. Our scripture reading comes from Psalm 23, "The Lord, the Shepherd of His People," a Psalm of David. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Amen.
This special music in the scripture in the end of the New Testament, it's 1 John chapter 2 verse 1 talks how Jesus is our advocate. He's not only our judge during the judgment, he's also our advocate. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So that's what this song is about, is comparing the courts of heaven to on earth too. I stood in the courtroom, the judge turned my way. It looks like you're guilty, so what do you say? I spoke up, Your Honor, I have no defense, but that's when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sin. Forgiveness when mercy walked in. I stood there in wonder, how could this be, that someone so guilty has just been set free? Chains were broken, I felt born again. The moment mercy walked in, mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sin. Forgiveness when mercy walked in. The blood was presented that covered my sin. Forgiveness when mercy walked in.
Amen.
Father, because Jesus loves me so, I'm depending on you to hold me fast. And not only me, Lord, but each one that has come here this morning with a heart that desires a personal touch from our Lord Jesus. For this really, Lord, is why we're here. Because there is a hole in our heart that only you can fill. So bend low, Lord, because we're expecting you to fellowship with us this morning and to fill that hole that is crying out for you. In Jesus' name, amen. You might want to take up your Bibles and turn with me to the text that our pastor shared with us last week in the book of Mark, in verses 40 and 41. I think you'll see why we're reviewing that as we move forward this morning. Looks like we have about 9 minutes and 20 seconds to finish. That clock is a terror. So I'm going to ask this morning that you extend grace and give me a special dispensation to run over a few minutes. Maybe you'll decide that as we go on, whether you want to do that or not. But I'm sure if the Lord is speaking to your heart, you'll not want to leave His presence. So we're in Mark 4, and you'll remember that Pastor Paul shared with us these verses. Beginning in verse 40 and 41. Of course, there is verses that precede that, that give us the context of it. But as the boat was filling, and I don't know about you, have any of you ever been on the sea, on the ocean? Chuck, anybody else? David, you've been on the lakes. Have you been on the ocean? You've been on the ocean. I was in the Coast Guard. And I was stationed in Newcastle, New Hampshire, and our patrol area included the North Atlantic Sea, up around Greenland, and we went there quite often. But when you go to the North Atlantic in the months of January, February, and March, the seas there run about 45 to 50 feet. And if you're in a small boat, which we were, 210 feet. Now, Dave, that's a little bit bigger boat. I don't know what size of the boat you were in or Chuck. But 210 feet in 40 and 50 foot swells, I can tell you, is not a very pleasant ride. Because the wind is blowing 50, 60, 70 miles an hour. It's treacherous to go out on the decks because the ocean actually freezes on the decks. You have to get out there with baseball bat-like implements and beat the ice off because it weighs down the ship. But the boats will, at least on a 210-foot boat, the swell comes up, it lifts the boat sticks out and hangs out there in space, and then crashes down, Heather. And with that rise, your stomach goes up. And with that fall, your stomach comes down. Now, I've never been in a boat that's filling with water. But the disciples were on the sea that night, as the pastor shared with us, in a storm that, unless you've been out in something like that, you probably can't comprehend the terror that it instills in you. Now, I can't fault the disciples for being afraid. Can you? I would be terrified too. So it is sort of a dilemma to me why Jesus reacted in the way that he did. And I want to share his response with you in verse 40 and 41. So let's read this together. And he said unto them, "Why are you so fearful?" Kind of a strange question when you're about ready to be swallowed up in the deep. Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly. Now, what were they afraid of now? This is a different thing, right? It says here they were fearful of the sea. And then it says, when Jesus spoke to them, they feared exceedingly and said to one another, "What manner of man is this, that even the wind and sea obey him?" So here they feared again. They feared not only the sea, but they feared when they began to recognize who it was that was in the boat with them. So this morning I want to talk with you a little bit about fear. The Roger's Thesaurus, if you go and look in that, I have a big one about this thick. It's about this big. I love it because it has big letters. And I went in there and I looked about fear. And there's a couple of pertinent terms that I want to discuss with you this morning. The one is fear of life, which we were talking about here. The disciples were afraid. The other one is the word anxiety. And that's the one I think that every one of us sitting here can relate to. We may not have had fearful, life-threatening situations, but we've all had fear in the term of anxiety. So we have these two key words in our text this morning, and I'd like to look at these three key words that Jesus related there. Fear, and fearful, and exceedingly fearful. You know, I wasn't old enough to live during the time when Franklin D. Roosevelt was president. Maybe some of you, in fact, some of you were. I know Elizabeth probably you were, and Richard you probably were. Chuck, maybe you were. Do you remember Franklin D.? No? Before your time. Okay. Franklin D. Roosevelt gave a speech during the Great Depression in the 30s, in which he said, coined a very famous saying or quotation. I think he probably came up with this himself. "We have nothing to fear but fear itself." Now, I don't know how he came up with that. It sounds pretty interesting. But he didn't go on and tell me how I could accomplish that. How is it that I could have no fear of anything but that I might fear? How is it that I could have no anxiety about anything but just to worry that I would have anxious thoughts? Well, I can't answer that because I never got a chance to talk with Franklin D. But I do know someone who does have the answer to that. He didn't quite put it that way. The first sense given in fear is the emotion of terror or fright. The disciples were fearful that they might die. They were in terror. They were in fright. For instance, I've noticed this in my wife. Not for me, by the way. Although I could be a terrorizer at some point, but I'm not. But I have noticed this. A mouse shows up in the kitchen, and immediately she screams and jumps on the chair in terror, because that was a very ferocious mouse. I don't have that fear of mouse. She does. I can't laugh at her too hard because then she gets mad at me. But there are some things I am afraid of. For instance, if I came face to face, Richard, with that lion that you talked about. Richard tells the story of his friend Chuck Town taking him into his zoo and walking him down the aisle in the back of the cages. And he didn't know what was going to happen, but when he got to the end of that cage, that lion jumped right out at him on that and landed on that cage and just about scared Richard. And I didn't think he was a coward, but that day he ran really fast. But if I came face to face with a lion, uncaged, I would be in terror. I don't know what I would do. I might faint right there. Or if I came face to face with a cobra, I'm terrified of snakes. I don't like them. Especially black mambas and cobras, because I hear the black mambas, they can get right up on their tail and they can run faster than you can. But I think I could run pretty fast. If a black mamba showed up on this stage, I'd be running pretty fast. So I'm terrified of black mambas and cobras and a lot of other snakes too. But gardener snakes, not too much. But what about an alligator? Have you ever seen those jaws? I watched an alligator on one of the nature shows grab a hold of an ox. I wouldn't want him to grab a hold of me. I'd be afraid of alligators. This is a natural God-given impulse that is for our protection. So some fears are legitimate and even enjoined. So let's take a look at a few of those. Matthew 10, just a few pages back from where we were in Mark. Matthew 10. Jesus speaking, and it's a little bit different than what he told the disciples. Matthew 10 and verse 28. I'll start in verse 27 to give the context. What I tell you in darkness, that speak in light. And what you hear in the ear, that preach ye in the housetops. And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul. So here we say, Jesus says, don't be afraid of those who can kill you physically. But he doesn't stop there. He says, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. So there's a legitimate fear. Not to fear what men can do to you, but have a fear for the one who can cast you into hell. There's another one in Hebrews. Paul talking to us now. Hebrews, the fourth chapter. I love Hebrews 4 because it talks about entering into Christ's rest. But before Paul talks about resting in Christ, he has this little admonition for us. Are you all there? Chapter 4, we're going to be right in the first verse. And Paul starts right out telling us to fear. And what does he tell us to fear there?
Rest.
I don't see rest there, Doris. Talks about rest. Let us therefore fear lest a promise of being left to us of entering his rest, any of you should come short of it. So if we were to say that in plain everyday English, what's the apostle telling us to fear? Isn't he saying, be afraid, be fearful that somehow you won't take advantage of the grace that's being offered you? In other words, be afraid of yourself. Think about that for a moment. You know I'm afraid of myself? In fact, I'm getting more afraid of myself all the time. You know why? Because I have a carnal heart. I was born that way. I don't know about you, but I was born that way. My genes in me tell me to trust in myself. They tell me to make my own plans. They tell me to do things to bring attention to myself. They tempt me, even when I stand in this pulpit, to endeavor to make you really want to like me. Now, those of you like Dave who have stood in this pulpit, you understand what I'm saying, Dave? So I'm afraid of myself. I'm afraid of my propensity to live independently of Jesus. So Paul says that's a legitimate fear. And as long as you hold that legitimate fear, you'll remember that your hope is in Jesus. And that it's in Him that you have to place your confidence, not in your strength and ability. And I would even venture to say that the church, Christ's church, should fear that we do the same thing. So the men in that boat that night had a human reason to fear or to be in terror for their lives. But Jesus indicated to them that their terror indicated that even though Jesus was with them, there was something crucial missing from their experience. And this lack would be revealed in all men when the final crisis in this world's history would break upon them. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Luke 21. And when you get to chapter 21, we're going to begin looking at this in verse 25. Luke, the 21st chapter, in verse 25. We there? Okay. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, what? Distress of nations and perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Now let's stop there just for a minute and understand what Jesus is saying here. He's saying that there's not only going to be signs in the sun, moon, and stars, in the physical universe in which we live of His soon coming, but there's going to be signs in the sea and the waves. Now in Bible prophecy, what do seas and waves represent? Seas represent peoples, tongues, and nations, and waves represent what? Tumultuous seas, like that North Atlantic Sea. And He said there's going to be signs in the universe in which we live, and there's going to be signs in the multitudes of this earth's population. And the sign is that there's going to be strife. And there's going to be perplexity. In other words, problems that human beings cannot seem to solve. Overwhelming problems. And the result of that was verse 26. Men's hearts failing them for what?
Fear.
They're terrified because they can't solve the problems. Human means and methods will always fail when you're dealing with carnal people. And even when you're dealing with those who are not carnal, when we look to human methods and means, we will always fail. Less powerful but just as deadly is the type of fear we know as anxiety or worry. Now, by the way, let's turn back to this verse 26 for a minute. Why are these men's hearts failing them for fear? Could it be that it's the same reason that the disciples were fearful? Could it be? So knowing that all human beings experience fear of one type or another, why does Jesus indicate to the disciples that their fear was an indication of a lack of faith? If we all agree, and I think we did, that it is justifiable and reasonable to think that you're, when you're about ready to be swallowed up into the depths, that there would be a natural fear, why does Jesus say that that fear indicated a lack of trust? You're on the right track, brother. So how would the Lord our God have us relate to each of these fears? Or should we fear at all? Was it not justifiable for them to fear? Well, let's look at a few texts that talk about fear. And then I think there's an answer that will open your understanding to this question of anxiety or fear and help us to relate to it in a better way that will bring glory to God. Psalms, the 27th chapter. We're going to look at about six texts here, and then we're going to try and pull all this thing together. Psalms. There's a person who wrote Psalms. He knew a little bit about fear. We're going to read the first five verses. If we're all there, let's begin. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though a host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, and behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. A few chapters over, chapter 46, same book. David again repeats Psalms 46. God is our, starting in verse 1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in what? Trouble. Though we, therefore, because he is our refuge and strength, we will not fear. Though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled. We talked about waters just a minute ago, right? Though the mountains shake with swelling thereof. Amen. Chapter 56, and David again repeats this. Verses 3 and 4. What time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. In God I will praise his word. In God I will praise his word. In God have I put my trust. I will not what? Fear what flesh can do to me. In other words, I am not going to fear other human beings. And then I would like to go back and really nail this down in our scripture reading this morning, Psalms, the 23rd chapter. And I'd like to concentrate for a moment on verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, what are the next words? Why? For thou art with me. What did David recognize? Didn't he recognize who the one was who was with him? Here we find the secret of our peace and steadiness under duress. When you pass through your troubles, I will be with you. In life or in death, I will not forsake you. You know, there was One of my most, I don't know how to express this, but almost emotional journeys was to read the life histories of the reformers, and especially the martyrs. And one of those was a man by the name of Jerome. Now, he is always coupled with another martyr by the name of John Huss in Bohemia. This was 100 years before Luther. This was just after Wycliffe. Huss and Jerome were prominent in the spreading of gospel truth in Bohemia. And their work was finding success. And it came to the notice of those in Rome. And they sent a papal delegation to talk with John Huss and to reason with them over their teachings. And, of course, they were faithful to the Word of God, and so they continued to preach, at which time they sent back a delegation of soldiers and arrested Huss and hustled them off to trial. Jerome was not with him at that time. So when he came to trial, he discovered that no matter what he said, his inquisitors were determined that his death was the only thing that would satisfy them. And so he gave his testimony. And when they burned him, he went singing, and he praised the Lord in his last moments as he perished in the flames. His lips simply were moving in hymns to God. Jerome had heard about his trial and had hustled as fast as he could, being impetuous, and had promised to never leave Huss's side to the place of trial. When he got there, he discovered that it was too late. There was nothing he could do. And so he turned around and fled away from the site. But soldiers had seen him there, and they pursued after him and arrested him and subsequently put him on trial. They terrified him so much with the threat of death that he recanted. But they didn't let him out of prison. So for 1 year, he was in a filthy dungeon thinking about what he had done. And the Holy Spirit was speaking to Jerome, and he, in the terror of his own conscience, determined that he would not forsake his God, and came close in prayer and fellowship with his Lord. And when he was called back into the trial 1 year later, being emaciated by being fed bread and water in a loathsome dungeon for 1 year, he stood boldly before his inquisitors and recanted his recantation, and lamented and only pleaded that God would forgive him and be merciful to him for misrepresenting him before these dignitaries. They shouted just like at Jesus' trial and said, "Away with this man." They brought him, they put the dunce's cap on him, they led him away to the stake. And as he went, Jerome began to sing a precious hymn about his relationship with the Lord. And he sang and he sang and he sang until they built the pile around him. And he said this very interesting thing when they started to light the fire. The man who was to light the fire went around the back of Jerome and began to start the pile to burn. And Jerome turned as best he could and said to the man, "Come out, my friend, my brother, and come before me and light the fire before me. Because if I was afraid of the fire, I would not be here." What happened to Jerome's fear? At first he failed. He feared. He betrayed his Lord and his friend out of fear of death, of what man could do to him. But there in the solitude of that loathsome dungeon, he saw again the face of his Lord. He saw him suffering in Pilate's judgment hall. He saw him hanging on the cross. He saw that he went there for him, and he was ashamed of his betrayal. And all fear left him as the Lord Jesus came close in fellowship and forgiveness. So, We see also in the story of the Hebrew boys. You remember Nebuchadnezzar in the story there, in the third chapter of Daniel, how that Nebuchadnezzar asked everyone to bow and show loyalty to him, and these three would refuse to bow. And what did they say when Nebuchadnezzar called them? They said, "We will not bow before an image, your image that you have constructed, Nebuchadnezzar, and we don't fear what you're going to do to us." And why did they not fear? I'd be afraid of that fire. But they weren't. And they weren't for one simple reason. Because God had promised through Isaiah the prophet that when you pass through the fires, I will be with you. And a few moments later, when they were thrown into the fire, indeed, what happened? Jesus showed up with them. That's why they didn't have any fear. You see. Now, Matthew says it this way, in quoting Isaiah, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, being interpreted, God with us." O blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. I will not fear though the earth be removed and the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with swelling thereof. Amen. Now, I want to go back to the disciples and help us to see why they feared both the sea and the man that was with them. Mark, the 10th chapter. Let's kind of pull all this thing together. We were in verse 40 and 41, I believe. Is it Mark? No, we were Mark 4. I'm sorry. Yeah, we were in Mark 4. Okay, if we're all there, let's read it again. "And he said unto them, Why are you so terrified? How is it that you have no trust?" So, why didn't they have trust? "And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Up to that point, to them, Jesus was a mighty prophet. Up to that point, they'd seen him do all kinds of miracles. They were attracted to the man. Their hearts were yearning to be closer to him. But evidently, they hadn't come to the realization that the one who was sleeping in that boat was the great I Am. The one who is with the Lord eternally. The eternal self-existent one. The one who had spoken this world into existence. And when they saw him still those waves by his own word, by the word of his mouth were the heavens made, it clicked. And they feared even as Isaiah feared when he said, "Woe is me, for I am undone. I am a man of unclean lips and dwell with the people of unclean lips, for I have seen the King." The disciples were fearing because they recognized at that point the reason that they were afraid of the waves is because they did not understand that the one who was with them in that boat was the one who created those waves. The one whose every atom in this universe responded in obedience to. Therefore, they were afraid. And for us, brothers and sisters, until we recognize that the one who is God with us, Emmanuel, the one who has promised to go through the fire with us, to never leave us or forsake us, is the one, the Almighty God, the Great I Am. So that we don't need to fear. We don't need to have all that anxiety. Because He has it in His hands. And that's why the Word says that I don't need to be afraid or to have anxiety, for the Lord will go before me and He'll finish the work that He's begun, not only in me, in my fear of my own carnal heart, but in the work that He has for us to do as a church. Oh Lord, this morning we understand that when we don't have Jesus, the Great I Am, when we don't recognize who He is, when we don't understand that He's promised to dwell within us and to work His eternal, self-existent life out in us, that we fear. But when we realize and when we believe and trust that He is with us and He will never forsake us, when we come to realize that His promises are sure, we can follow the confident advice of the Apostle Paul when he says there remains now a rest for the people of God. And we can rest confidently in Him who is our refuge and our strength, and our Redeemer. Amen and amen. Amen. Brother Dan, lead us in our closing hymn.
The closing hymn is number 529. Stand.
Yes, Lord, we desire to be under your wings, to find rest for our souls and strength for the challenges that will be before us. Now, Lord, to him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultly before the throne of grace, to him, the everlasting God, the Almighty, the I Am, be blessings and honor and glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever. The Lord be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever.